No one has more state pride than New Mexicans. The vibrant culture, bold flavors, unique history, and dramatic landscapes under our Zia sun are like no other. And the people of New Mexico are a rare breed. As diverse as we are, together we breathe life and soul into this high desert land, a land that promises adventure. I'm Michael Newman, and as your host, I'll be taking you with me as I seek out the best the land of enchantment has to offer.
New Mexico feels like home to me. It feels so true. It's time well spent when I spend it.
Thanks for tuning in for another episode of New Mexico True Television. I'm your host, Michael Newman. In this episode, we visit places that help us get back to our roots. From pre-Columbian dwellings to Spanish colonial villages, ghost towns, and remnants from Western pioneers, we celebrate the rich tricultural heritage of our state. On the southern outskirts of Santa Fe, off I-25 at exit 276, is the historic property El Rancho de las Golondrinas. El Rancho de las Golondrinas, or Rancho the Swallows, is our state's only living history museum. With a collection of buildings dating back as early as the 1700s, this 200-acre property allows you to step back in time, enveloping you under its cottonwood trees and inviting you into its adobe structures, attentively furnished with items and artifacts of the era. In its early days, this historic ranch served as the last encampment along El Camino Real, serving as a respite for weary travelers making the long journey along the Royal Road from Mexico City to Santa Fe and San Juan Pueblo. Today, with regularly scheduled festivals and events, the Rancho gives visitors a chance to experience the many historic chapters of this site in the fertile valley of La Cienega. In a very hands-on fashion, you're able to become acquainted with nearly 200 years of history, from Spanish, colonial, and Mexican, to life in territorial New Mexico. Each era is encapsulated in this one unique place. Among the spots I had the chance to check out was the Manuel Apodaca blacksmith shop, where tools, household utensils, and items for the ranch were crafted.
So that's about a bright lemon right there, so at about 2300 degrees.
Meanwhile, other visitors headed for the classroom of the old Raton schoolhouse, all of us getting an authentic first-hand experience of day-to-day life in these times. This weekend, they are holding a fiber arts fair, complete with sheep shearing and demonstrations of traditional spinning and weaving. One thing I can say for sure, I don't know if I could have been the one to shear the sheep back in the day. Seems a bit precarious, especially with a mama sheep, to navigate the udder through that thick wool with those heavy-duty shears. It's incredible there are so many people at the ranch who have carried on the traditions of these age-old crafts. With today's generations yearning to get back to their roots and reconnect with the land, grow their own food, and learn the skills of their forefathers, myself being one of them, this type of experience becomes all the more relevant.
Couching stitch, we call it. Right.
Ultimately, it is not just an interactive history lesson, but an eye-opening experience to the feasibility and excitement of learning these crafts oneself.
I see you're working on the red chilies over there.
Yeah, I took out the seeds because it adds more flavor to the chili if you roast it. Yeah.
So this is how they did it in the old days.
Yeah, and then I would grind it and make my red chili. Would you like a biscochito?
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Homemade?
Homemade. Oh. I have this kind and I have this kind. Ooh. You see how it's made like a star?
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's called estrellita.
Estrellita.
Okay. Uh-huh. And then this one, biscochitos, has little deditos on it. And they're made in thick. They're made thick because it's like a biscuit.
Mm-hmm.
And I learned this from my great grandmother and my mother. You get the. It's different from a regular sugar cookie. You get the flour.
Mm.
You put all the lard in it, then the sugar, and then fresh ground cinnamon.
Mm.
And then you mix it together. Then you add your water. So because it gives it a different biscuit kind of.
Right. It's delicious and it's thicker than I'm used to.
And the baking powder. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
That's great. And it actually feels like a biscuit.
Uh-huh. And the ditos are the little toes right here.
Mm-hmm.
So these were made special. Like for a baptism or for a wedding.
Oh, okay. That's so traditional, biscochitos had a traditional use as well.
Yes.
Okay. Uh-huh.
And then this would be just plain if you make cookies for the cookies for the kids. Yeah. So, did you like some homemade bread?
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness. You're treating me so good.
See the eggs that we got?
Farm fresh eggs.
Yeah.
I mean, it's so simple. Like, it seems like it would be hard to do long term, but people did it, and this is like nothing.
I like this because it's more natural and it's not work.
Right.
To me, it's not work.
Living.
Yeah, you're living. It's survival, and I like that. Mm-hmm. I like that a lot too. So.
With the expansive property and the number of buildings to visit, you'll want to devote a good chunk of time for your visit to the Rancho. Make a day of it. Be sure and come with room in your stomach for the food, there are many stations set up where you can sample some of the rustic breads and preserves and even take a stab at making your own. And if you want a more instructive lesson on baking bread, they offer special Orno bread baking classes twice a week. Up next, we visit one of our state's most ancient dwelling sites. Sign up to receive monthly newsletters about events and happenings around the state at newmexico.org. And now, from the pages of New Mexico Magazine. Chaco Culture National Historical Park, known to many as Chaco Canyon, is located just under 3 hours northwest of Albuquerque off US 550 and Road 7900. In this remote canyon away from much of today's civilization, the ancient Chacoan Pueblo people once thrived. With short growing seasons and long harsh winters, it's somewhat surprising that this site in the San Juan Basin served as a hub for people over 1,000 years ago. Yet the grand scope and style of architecture is undeniable. Chaco was a centerpiece of culture and economic activity in its day, surviving here more than 300 years. The stone structures of Chaco were unlike anything built prior, and the hundreds of rooms and multiple kivas reaching 4 or 5 stories high are evidence of an extremely advanced and sophisticated society. In the construction of these buildings, the Chacoan people referenced solar, lunar, and cardinal directions, paralleling celestial alignments. And many buildings were placed within line of sight for the purpose of communication. Every element was engineered with the utmost precision. Not to mention, the mere placement of the site is among sacred mountains, mesas, and shrines for the Pueblo people. For all of these reasons and more, the energy field of Chaco is powerful. There is definitely an inherent mystical and magical quality to be experienced here. Wandering through the narrow passageways and crouching through the low doorways before entering into the expansiveness of the great rooms is something that needs to be experienced firsthand.
Whoa. That is huge.
The solidity of these time-tested structures and the pristine stonework is worthy of our admiration, while the textures revealed through the layers of rock, along with the depth of multiple rooms and doorways, makes for a photographer's paradise. The permanence of these structures draws a stark contrast to their initial use. General consensus is the ancient Puebloans did not inhabit these rooms year-round, but instead came here periodically for public gatherings, trade, and ceremonies, returning later to their permanent homes elsewhere. That said, the emphasis on Chaco's use for ritual and ceremonial purposes is growing, and the sheer numbers of kivas on the premises supports this theory.
I have to say it's very humbling to think that I'm standing in the same place that a human did over 1,500 years ago, and using this ceremonial space, the kiva, for their traditions and their ceremonies every year, and the fact that we're standing here and it's so well preserved, it's really astounding.
In looking over the expansiveness of the ruins within this canyon, I find it even more remarkable Chaco was merely the center of a larger network of pueblos spreading throughout the Four Corners region, with outlier communities and great houses of Chacoan culture reaching all the way into Arizona, Colorado, and Utah, most notably Mesa Verde. Perhaps lesser known, but also impressive, are the Aztec ruins, located along the Animas River in the city of Aztec. Its very name reveals the mistaken notion by white settlers that the ruins were Aztec in origin, versus their rightful identity relating to the ancestral Pueblo peoples. And today, there is no room for doubt of the Chacoan influence on this site. The ruins are comprised of multi-story great houses as well as smaller pueblos and a great kiva, which was reconstructed in 1934 under the direction of Earl H. Morris of New York City's American Museum of Natural History. The West Ruin once had more than 500 rooms centered on an open plaza, many of which still have the original wooden roofs. Walking through these rooms with their roofs intact is an experience I have not had elsewhere, proof that along the trail of the ancients connecting these sites, each location offers a new perspective and a unique experience, altogether impressing upon me the power and magnitude of this part of our state's culture. For those of you more adventuresome and willing to go off the beaten path and in a high-clearance vehicle, look into the outlier ruins of Pueblo Pintado and Guadalupe Ruin. And do not leave town without trying the amazing Thai cuisine at Tan Tip Cafe on South Main Avenue in Aztec. For more great stories like this from New Mexico Magazine, visit newmexico.org. Stay tuned for a look inside a time capsule in chloride. If you missed an episode or just want to see more of New Mexico True TV, visit our YouTube page at youtube.com/visitnewmexico. There you can find all of our full episodes and segments. great day trip from Truth or Consequences takes you out on New Mexico Highway 52, on one of the state's most scenic stretches of road, and through some unforgettable ghost towns. I'm making my way to Chloride. This town had its boom after word got out that Harry Pye discovered silver ore here. And as the case with all boom towns, it went bust. It stood abandoned for the most part until Don Edmond made his way into town. Don is the man chiefly responsible for bringing the abandoned ghost town back to the splendor of the late 1800s, and he's going to show me around today.
Where are we right now?
Well, we're at the Mighty Crystal Saloon and Dance Hall.
Okay.
It was built in 1880, ran for 4 years as a saloon, and then in 1884 it became a schoolhouse. It was a schoolhouse for some years, and it did other things, and now it's a gift shop and gallery.
Huh.
It's all restored. There's about 30 local people who display their things in there.
So this is a perfect example of something that had some history.
It's got some history, and it's still in use.
Oh, I love that. Okay. So let's take a ride.
Okay, we'll go take a ride. The building we're coming up on here on the right, that was the bank, built to be the bank in 1884. Failed before it opened. Opened as the bank saloon. It was the ninth saloon in town. This is Pye's Cabin. This was the first building in Chloride. It was built in 1879.
Wow.
He and two men built this before they started mining. The Indians killed him about 3 months later. We're coming up on the hanging tree here on the left. We asked the old timers what the story was about the hanging tree, and they said nobody really hung by the neck. And on weekends, or when the miners or cowboys were in town, if they got too rambunctious from too much to drink, they'd dunk them in the tank and chain them to the tree until they realized the error of their ways. This was the judge's office, built in 1880 by Judge Holmes. And then it was, it's a post office after that, and then a gambling den and a dance hall.
So that building is kind of transformed.
Yeah,
over the
years. That's kind of common with buildings here. They went through a lot of things.
Of all Don's fascinating historic tales, my favorite story was how he came to be a resident of Chloride himself.
Labor Day weekend, 1977, we were looking for Wall Lake over in Gila. I made a wrong turn in Winston, and we wound up down the road here. Not even gravel, just dirt.
Just dirt.
And I told my wife, I said, I'm on the wrong road, we gotta turn around. And she said, I see some rooftops, let's drive up there. So we drove up here, and these are all derelicts. One of these buildings was derelicts. We thought we'd stumbled onto a deserted movie set. So we parked at the west end and looked down the street, and we were absolutely entranced. And my wife said, if this is deserted and if it's available, this is where we need to live.
I wanted to ask you too, I mean, what sustained you, to rebuild and rehabilitate this whole area? Because it's a lot of work.
Yeah, it is. I'm ambitious, and I can do it. And keeps me off the bar and off the street corners. We just got interested in the history, and I thought we'd try to save it. So we've done, I think, 10 buildings here. I have two in process now, and two or three more that we'll do.
And now the highlight of my tour. The general store.
Come on in, Michael.
Oh, man.
This is what we found.
Everything intact.
The Pioneer Store is one of the more amazing stores that come out of Chloride. After the mining boom went bust, the store was leased out in 1896. While it changed hands over the years, it ultimately closed and was boarded up in 1923. It remained boarded and sealed up for 73 years. So when Don came to town, he found the Pioneer Store locked up untouched, frozen in time since 1923.
And this should be a museum, but it was obvious.
Everything is already set in place for it to be a museum.
So we put things back pretty much where they were. We saved some of the boxes.
Let's see. I want to see some of these.
They may have holes in the back, but they're
like
they're,
some. They're, I mean, when did these date back to? What would you say?
Well, 1880 to 1923.
1880s. So some of the stuff they don't even make anymore.
The newest stuff here would be 1923.
Wow.
Post office was established here in 1881 in this corner.
Original typewriter, all that stuff?
That was here.
Yeah. No way.
The newspaper was printed upstairs, so this was kind of the center of town.
What's your favorite item out of everything?
This thing right here.
This guy?
Yeah, that's that thing right there. That's a fireproof credit system. They heat it with wood, have wood roofs. They catch on fire. They lose their inventory, but their biggest losses were these books.
Wow.
There are a whole page of these. That's written to Alejandro Salas. It's dated May 8th, 1911. It's for 20 cents worth of cheese and 5 cents worth of chocolate.
No,
and it's still not paid.
No, so they're still indebted to this
place.
Yeah.
This is the father of the food processor. That's a butter churn.
Butter churn here.
Commercial size.
Oh, man. I mean, you really feel like you're there.
It's a time capsule.
And that is for dynamite.
Yeah, all the kids know what that is, Mike.
Yeah. Oh, man. Uh-oh.
How do you like that?
Oh, this is the dentist
chair?
That's
the dentist chair. Isn't it terrible? They tell me that the barbers did the dental work.
Oh, man.
And this, I don't know why it got stored in here. They told me that that would have been in the barbershop.
I was blown away by the countless treasures found in this old general store. And to think, this time capsule of a place exists just 40 miles off the beaten path from Elephant Butte and TRC. It's truly awesome.
Where a big tourist destination is and off the beaten path, you can find a place like Chloride. And, you know, the history here and the people that came through this town. And, you know, it's right next to the Gila Wilderness. And I don't know, it's just something that is very special about a town like this that you can't find in many places. Many people in New Mexico kind of find that. But if you're not adventurous, if you're not trying to get out of your comfort zone, you're never going to find a place like this. But it takes a little bit of heart and a little bit of sacrifice, I think, to restore a place like this and to really take it in and call it home.
Before you hit the road, here's some tips for your visit to Chloride. Chloride is just 40 miles northwest of TRC on Highway 52. This town is open for business 7 days a week. In addition to the General Store Museum, be sure and visit the gift shop and gallery representing local artists. Chloride is not the only high point along this stretch of road. Be sure to stop and check out the ghost towns of Winston and Cuchillo along the way. And now, here's another New Mexico true treasure.
Hi, I'm Martin Ledger, and Bandelier National Monument is a New Mexico true treasure. Bandelier is amazing because not only can you, it's not like a museum where everything is behind a glass wall, but you can actually go into the ruins, you can touch them, you can climb the ladders, and you can experience and look down on the valley and say, wow, that's what the people saw. That's what they saw when they got up in the morning. They hauled water up here, they hauled food up here, they hauled their families up there. It's just amazing to be able to touch and live that. I think the mystery of the Anasazis is not only true and one of the most intriguing mysteries for Bandelier, but for all the culture of New Mexico, from Chaco Canyon to the other historical sites. It's truly an amazing culture that was built up and thrived and then suddenly disappeared.
Up next, an entire pioneer village in downtown Aztec.
Do you take a lot of pictures on your New Mexico travels? Well, if you do, show us by hashtagging New Mexico True on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram.
Situated in the heart of Aztec on North Main Avenue is the Aztec Museum and Pioneer Village, just under 3 hours northwest of Albuquerque on US 550 North. This museum and the 12 buildings comprising the Pioneer Village provide a unique glimpse into life in the San Juan Basin during the early 20th century. Being able to step inside the buildings and examine the historical items housed in each one feels like walking back in time to the Aztec of yesteryear. Remnants and relics from this area's early settlers are displayed in such a manner so it feels as if the people once inhabiting these spaces perhaps just stepped away momentarily, possibly returning at any given moment. You get a real sense of what it felt like to sit in an early 1900s schoolhouse, and what goods you may have found on the shelves of the General Mercantile, or what the accommodations of a train caboose looked like. You may feel humbled upon entering the modest log cabin of an early pioneer, or curious about the career demands of the town physician and local sheriff. And you can almost hear the echoes of chatter in the old school barbershop. For here, history is alive and well, and you'd be hard-pressed to find a better presentation of life in the early days of the American West. Sharing this sentiment are two chaps I met outside the general store, Jimmy and Jacob.
So Jimmy, can you briefly describe this treasure you have here?
Well, Aztec was actually founded in 1890. We are trying to get as many of the buildings and exhibits as we can that represent that turn of the 20th century period. All of the buildings were either built on site as replicas of existing buildings, or in some cases, such as the blacksmith shop there, they were actually disassembled, moved in here, reassembled by a very dedicated group of volunteers. Example is our little chapel that came from Cedar Hill. They disassembled it and—
Every piece of it?
Yes.
Wow.
Reassembled it, in fact, brought in the pews, mm-hmm. The pulpit, all those things are original from the Cedar Hill Church. And we actually have weddings there now.
Oh, wow. That's a lot of commitment, man. I'll tell you. It's like taking apart Lego pieces and putting it back together. Yeah, make sure you have every little piece.
With old wood that might be half rotted. Yeah, that's true.
That's amazing. So how is this kind of reflective of what life was like then?
So Aztecs started out primarily as an agricultural community. Of course, the Animas River flows right through Aztec, and that provided water for irrigation. It grew into a fairly sizable settlement within a matter of less than 10 years. It was the hub of San Juan County.
Jacob, you have been here, or your family has been here for how many generations?
I'm a fifth generation.
Fifth generation. There's not many people that can say that they know where their great-great-great,
grandparents came from.
Right.
That's... Yeah, we're here. We settled here in 1906. We're cattle and ranching, mm-hmm. and we still do that to this day.
Right. So has there been a lot of heirlooms and relics from that time that you've seen?
That's why I like the museum so much. It just kind of puts me back into the past to how it used to be.
Right.
And that's the gift that this has to offer.
Do not miss the hand-carved wooden cyclorama of the Pecos West. Nearly 18 feet in diameter with wonderful music and narration, this item is a gem like no other I've seen. Look for the mock nuclear fracking device from the Gas Buggy Project in the oil and gas exhibit. And if you get hungry, grab a bite at Atomic Espresso and Bistro across the street. There's no denying our state is full of history, and we're fortunate the heritage of those who walked before us is so accessible today. With that being said, what are you doing next weekend?